Just to kick things off, when this next guest was first approached by Tangata Pacifica about telling a story, she was in the humility of Pacifica people, and she actually even said, "Do I have a story to tell?" To be honest, she has one heck of a story to tell, which involves sheer determination and the pursuit of change. It's a story of both smashing stereotypes and boundaries. Ladies and gentlemen, I'll welcome to the stage Louisa Winters. Hello, Louisa. Grab a seat. It was only about a week ago that we caught up in the cafe. That was certainly a laugh with the Coast facilitator, Eugene. Great insight to the story. And I can't believe, Louisa, after everything you've done, bodybuilding, Ironman, you thought you didn't have a story to tell?
I didn't realise I had a story to tell until I asked one of my friends, which is Jodie, because I was doing it every day, and I didn't realise that I was, you know, a Pacific woman doing something different. She made me realise how I could put it out there and encourage, you know, Pacific Islanders, where, you know, my friends. And I didn't realise I was doing something that was different from what a normal Tongan woman would do at this age.
And saying that, if we rewind a bit, where were you brought up, born? Was it here or overseas?
I was born in Tonga, in the island of Tonga, Nukualofa. And I came here when I was 11 years old.
And what was it like when you first got to New Zealand from Tonga? And what was the upbringing like? Where were you based when you first got to New Zealand?
When we were based in St. Luke's, and my parents passed away, I was made orphaned at a young age, so we were brought up with my auntie and uncle, and we lived in St. Luke's, across from St. Luke's Mall. I went to Auckland Girls, so every day I'd walk from St. Luke's to Auckland Girls to save my 50 cents for Sally Lung on K Road, to buy Sally Lung on K Road. So in those days there were no motorways, so I used to cut through Bond Street across and take a shortcut.
And what were you like as a child? You know, being originally born Tonga, you probably spoke a couple of languages. What was it like? Were there other Pacifica people, Tongans, at your school?
At Auckland Girls, we were put into classes where there was the class I was in didn't speak English very well, so I had language barrier. So I did as best as I could to cope with school. Because I arrived when I was 11, I went to Kōwhai Intermediate. I still didn't understand English that well. And so, yeah.
So would you say school was, from I guess that young age through the high school years, was pretty tough? How did you do in school? Did you enjoy any of the subjects? Did you not enjoy them? Did you sort of distance yourself from education in that sense?
To tell you the truth, I didn't enjoy school at all, but I enjoyed sport. So anything to do with sport, I would give it a go. And you put me in the library or in front of a book, I would go to sleep.
So you're saying that you... what happened when you went to the library? Did you go to sleep when you went to the library or...?
In the library, of course.
So what sports were you playing then when you were at high school or growing up? What sports were you into?
I was into netball, diving, pretending I knew how to swim, Jason. I would hold my breath, Auckland Girls, I would hold my breath. Luckily it was only 25 metres, I think. I'd hold my breath to the
That's
other
still
end.
A good effort.
But I came first.
Jason talked about being first earlier as well. Why were you coming first in all the races? How was that?
In the race. race and the...
Swimming race. Or was this another race?
Oh, I did athletics. I win the trophies for running and stuff. And, yeah, sportsman of the year.
So from a young age, you're quite sporty. You didn't like the education side. Where were your brothers and sisters at the stage? Are you obviously the...
The oldest child of five siblings. Two boys and two sisters, one that's passed away recently, Teresa, who was very close to me, and she helped me look after the other boys.
Well, this was going to say, being the oldest, I'm one of the oldest too, you kind of looked at as to try to set an example, look after the others. Is that what you were as well? You know, where were your parents at this stage? Were they looking after you, or were you sort of the mother figure for them growing up?
When my parents passed away, I was 11 and the rest were much younger. I sort of grew up really fast. I knew I had to help look after them. We were brought up with our auntie and uncle, but they had their own children. They had six children, so we were, you know, you had to help out in different areas. So when I didn't really have any direction or anything, but all I cared about was finishing school, find a job, and help pay for the rent or whatever.
So how many people were living in the household growing up? It almost did a count of about...
Plus the two parents.
So 13 yeah. All up. Wow, that, so that would have been a really busy household.
We ate a lot of stews Monday to Friday. I used to go to Auckland Girls with... we used to have Vegemite sandwiches from Monday to Friday. Sad, but I used to go and swap mine.
For what?
I used to swap for Phil Roll. Remember Phil Roll or pie?
At that age, because you'd been thrown into sort of quite an adult or parenthood type figure, did you have dreams? What were your dreams growing up? Did you have any? Or was it just survival of the fittest?
Survival. Well, all I wanted was, I didn't have any direction because my parents passed away. I didn't have any, like I said, I wanted to just work and help and help look after my siblings. I didn't have any dreams or anything. All I wanted was a nice home, nice food, maybe have my own room. We used to have like five of us girls in one room, and our wardrobes would be, all our belongings would be in cardboard boxes, you know. That was your wardrobe.
Man, that sounds like quite a busy household.
And so when I left school, I went to work, and most of my wages went towards the care of my siblings. Yes.
So fast forwarding a few years, you obviously had children, and what was your goal once you had those children? Was it to give them a different life to what you had?
Definitely. I wanted to bring them up in a way that I didn't want them to go through what I went through. I was so determined to give them a better life. And, yes.
What steps did you take or try to do when you did have the children to make it different from the upbringing that you'd had?
What steps did I do? I had to change the way I lived. In the way I looked at life, I had to change a lot of my ways that I've. Yes, I had to set an example, perhaps.
And when it came to some of the, because you know we were talking to Jason earlier, he'd sort of been fighting from a young age. You'd been fighting in a different way. What then brought on the step to say, hey, I'm going to do a triathlon? I mean, you don't just walk into it. Who got you inspired? Who motivated you to even give that a go?
Well, my husband got diagnosed with Hodgkin's, which is a blood disorder, cancer. And so he was a heavy smoker. I was a heavy smoker. And so we stopped together at the same time when he got diagnosed. So I started eating. I use food.
What, not like Vegemite sandwiches, casseroles? What sort of food were you eating? KFC?
And a bit of wine on the side. I ate, you know, I just ballooned, right?
What are we talking? What was your weight?
104.
Okay.
Which I'm nearly there now, but yeah. So I decided to put one foot in front of the other and start walking to change my ways. And the kids were only little. You know, I wanted to live a bit longer than.
And was it just, look, I'm going to start walking 3K a day. Then how did it turn into a walk to a triathlon?
I walked and then I got fitter and then I started running. Can I have a drink of water?
Yeah, this one, just right there, yeah.
I'm telling lies. And then I started running and then I decided to go and learn how to swim, Jason, because a lot of islanders don't know how to swim. They live by the sea, but they never learn how to swim. We used to just go.
Yeah, that always baffles me, right? Like, this is a really good point to make. Live by the sea, but don't swim.
That's right. And so I went to swimming. I went to find out if I could join an adult swimming class. So there was one there, and I joined up, and I met up with a group of triathletes training for Ironman. And so, yeah, they were very encouraging and very positive and just generally amazing, you know.
Were any Tongan or were you the only Tongan, no, sort of Polynesian?
Spot the black.
What did you say? Spot the darky? Is that what it was like?
I was there.
Did they think you were there to race or what? What was the go? Because we talked about it earlier. You said you've sort of encountered a little bit of racism along the way.
Yeah, when I first started doing triathlon, there was hardly any Polynesians, or right. So when you see one on the running in the race, you go, "Wow, hi, bro!" Kia ora. Yeah, keep going. Yeah.
So you're very, very supportive of the Polynesian people.
Yes, but now there's heaps of people, obviously, and so I just went along, and they were really, really great. And so we started riding and running.
I'm just trying to figure it, like, you know, the discipline involved, because looking out there tonight, you can't just run a triathlon or a marathon, an Ironman, without doing anything and having that discipline. So you had to build that up. Did you just, each day, did you just get stronger and stronger, build on that, and then say, I'm doing a triathlon next week? And what was the effect and result and reaction from people around you when you told them that you're going to do this?
They said, oh, well, you can't swim. Said, well, I've got other things to help me swim, you know. But, you know, like I said to you that time when I talked to you, I said I love doubters.
So haters are your motivators?
Yes. So I thought, right, I'll show you. Anyway, so the training was hard. I went with this group. They're really... So you have to discipline yourself. You have to be organized. You have to be on time, Vanessa. and stick to your training program.
So no KFC, no Vegemite sandwiches. Did you have to be quite strict with your diet as well?
Not too strict, but, you know, no KFC, obviously. And yes, so where was I?
Well, you just finished, we're going to do a triathlon. You had completed, you told people you're going to do it. They said you can't swim. Then you went and did it.
And I did a lot of training, obviously, and then did the half Ironman to get prepared. So I went on a bike. I did a lot of biking. Did K1, which is out in Coromandel, Kaupo Hills. And then the next day, I'd run the Auckland Half Marathon. And then you have a rest and go to work the next day.
So for those that don't know, what's a half marathon? What's the distance of each race?
That's 21K.
Run? Yep.
Run. And full marathon is 42K.
And the swim, bike as well, is it?
Are you talking about the half?
Yeah, the half Ironman.
And the bike is 90 kilometres. So you swim first. 2K, then you get out and then you bike, what is it, Vanessa? 90K, and then you run 21K.
Yeah, somebody said you're crazy. And then you went on to do a full Ironman.
Which is double that.
Oh, yeah. Goodness. And once again, that would have taken even more determination, more willpower, more training. You know, when you were doing this, were people around you amazed? Were you even amazed of yourself? Like a year before, you got up to 104, you hadn't been doing too much, and then a year or two down the track, you're running Ironmans. Ironwomans.
Yes, because I lost weight, and you're amongst people that I think alike, and are very encouraging and positive, and you don't realise that you're actually doing that. Something amazing until somebody says to you, wow, you could swim after all, you know, like...
Was that the catalyst too for getting into bodybuilding? Bikinis, that kind of thing? I mean, growing up, did you even wear a bikini?
No, not in Tonga. You'd be shocked.
So no bikinis in Tonga, right?
No, so I wanted to wear a bikini anyway, so I went to, I got sick of training for triathlons, and then I did the bodybuilding, body sculpting,
and
not building.
Was it just, obviously more than the bikini, but was it like, well, look, I've done the triathlons, I've done the Ironmans, I need a new challenge.
To do the bodybuilding?
Yes.
Yes, that's why I wanted to do something different. And also, it was challenging because the food was different from... On triathlons, you have to eat, you have to fuel your body to train, but with body sculpting, you have to eat less, and then your training gets really heavy at the end, towards the end. And then I came third. There was only three people.
Still give it a go.
But wow, I did it. And then I got into the nationals, but I didn't want to do it because I was too hungry.
You know,
Northern Islander.
If you ever get the chance,
hungry, honestly,
you've got to see the photos. I was blown away. I mean, jeepers, you looked amazing.
Thank you.
You know, how hard was that too? I mean, we were talking about KFC before, whatnot. Did you have to change your whole lifestyle and eat quite separately from the family, the whānau? How was the support with them during that phase?
They were really good. Yes, they didn't mind because they were got them into health. They were eating healthily. They were very encouraging. Oh, I have four boys and no girls, but they're really, really beautiful boys. There's two here, three here. Put your hands up. They're gone. Oh, here we are.
There's one.
Yes, three boys here, one over in the States. Yes, they were really very good with their food. They just left me alone because I was the only girl in the house, and you know, do my thing.
Looking at and talking about your early life and to what you do now, and obviously for your boys here tonight, you must have been an amazing inspiration to them. You know, the way that you do things is. You simplify it down. You just do it. You don't think about it one foot in front of the other. And have they ever said to you as well, or have people around you said, man, Louisa, you're an inspiration. You're bloody amazing.
Do the boys...
And people around you, do they say that to you? Or do you feel that you are quite an impact on people around you?
No, I just feel normal, like just like anyone that... I mean, I don't really...
It's not normal to run an Iron Man and then do racing the next day and go to work. It's just simply amazing.
Yes, it's nice.
And in saying that, one of the last catalysts for changes you went on to be an anaesthetic technician through, I guess, sheer determination, right? Because medical or that wasn't your background or history. So you worked at a hospital for many years now, and how did that journey start?
I went back after my first Ironman. I went back to work. I was a receptionist in the hospital, in the emergency department, and I felt that was the change. That was the change. I said, I need to challenge myself. You know, after you do the Ironman, I thought I could do anything, you know. And the because I was looking for change, I suppose, the job presented itself, you know, in front of my face, the anaesthetic training job, and it required me to train for 3 years, AUT, Auckland University of Technology, to study 3 years of anaesthesia and training on the job. And also, yes, it was quite a challenge, which I enjoyed because I wanted something to keep me, my mind going. And
do you feel the background training with, you know, being an Iron Woman, bodybuilding, set you up for this next challenge in terms of academia?
I think so. I applied the same principle from training, the discipline, focusing and not letting other distractions distract you from your goal. Yes, I applied the same principle to the study. I mean, at school, the only thing I passed, I think, was human biology, which did come in handy.
Yeah, I was going to say that.
Human biology at school.
Didn't that come into to play or help later on down the track with bodybuilding,
yeah.
Ironmans?
And so, yes. But I was lucky because I had good mentors and I had a trainer, Muriel Cooper, who tapped into my conscience, where she would remind me of when I found things really hard, like biophysics.
That word even confuses me.
I've never looked at a book before. And she reminded me, get into your secret place. Remember, you've done Ironman. Get into your, you know, like, and it just brought me back. You know, I snapped out of it and just carry on persevering. And I got there.
That's the thing, too. Listen to your story now. It doesn't sound like you had a mentor growing up. You were your own mentor going through that journey. Later on in life with, you know, going down the track of education, it was probably good to have a mentor, but you kind of got to where you were without that, right?
I always believe that if you're looking for change, you know, things will come into fruition. You know, like, did I say that properly? Anyway, Yes. If you're looking for change, you will attract, you know, attract change. Things will come in front of, they'll just appear in front of you. And if you just don't want to change, you just want to, well, nothing's going to happen.
Would you admit you're a little bit stubborn as well? You kind of want to get something done your way and will ignore the opinion of others to get to where you want?
I love other people's criticism. I feel that makes you grow, you know. I take advice from my friends. I take anybody's advice.
So what's next then? You've done bodybuilding, you've done Ironmans, you've done triathlons, you've received your qualification and as an anaesthetic technician. I mean, that bucket list is, you know, rising and rising. What really next do you have to achieve or want to achieve for your personal memoir, in a sense?
I want to complete my memoir for my children. I want to be able to help others change as well, or maybe I can help one person. I want my children to be proud of me, and I want to leave a legacy to pass on to their children. I want them to believe in themselves.
You know, after hearing your story tonight, and you talking about competing in Ironmans, triathlons, the qualifications you have, I'm inspired. I'm sure people out there would be as well. You're a complete inspiration. Whether you know it or not, I'm certainly inspired and
thank you.
Really privileged to hear your story tonight. Anything you want to say lastly to anyone watching in attendance tonight?
Go for your dreams. Anyone can do it. Doesn't matter where you come from or what colour you are. You know, you put your mind to it. Believe in yourself. I know it sounds cliche, but you can do it. Doesn't matter how down you are, you get up and you just put one foot in front of the other. I, I, that's, I, that's what I believe. It helped me a lot.
There you have it, from an iron woman herself. Ladies and gentlemen, Louisa Winters.
Thank you.
Somebody get her a wine. Or not. All right, folks, we're going to have a 1 minute break, and then we've got, last but not least, Shane White. So go to the loo, grab any chips or water if there's any left, and then we've got Shane White.